Hello, I'm Dr. Steve Kopecky. We're here for another one of our interviews with the experts, cardiovascular disease. Today is one of our prevention podcasts with my friend and colleague, Dr. Tom Gerber. Welcome, Tom.
Thank you, Steve, for having me.
We'll be discussing CT scan for coronary artery calcification, when to do it, when not to do it, and what are the pitfalls. Tom's a real expert in this area. So Tom, tell us, how is a CT scan for calcium done, and what can the results tell us about cardiovascular risk of the patient and management?
So the CT scan or the coronary calcification scan will look for all means and purposes like a simple CT scan. They'll have the patient on a typical CT machine, but the entire process, taking the images, takes less than 10 seconds, and then they're done. The patient will not need an IV. There will be no fluids going in. And also, I want to mention that the radiation exposure related to a CT scan like that is very low. 20 years ago, we heard all these scary stories, how we were killing 200,000 Americans per year with medical radiation related to imaging. That was scaremongering at the time. Again, the dose from a CT of that kind is very low and would not increase a patient's risk. So no reason to shy away from having that test done just because it involved x-rays.
What does it tell us? What does a CT scan for calcium really tell us?
So what the CT does is it shows calcification in the heart arteries. And calcification is a marker of the beginning of the hardening of the arteries, atherosclerosis. And anatomists have known since the 1700s or 1600s that calcium is associated with vascular disease. When people first started doing fluoroscopy of the lungs, they were able to notice heavy coronary calcification. And it turns out that CT is exquisitely sensitive to calcium, including coronary calcification. So the CT can show us whether or not there is calcification in the heart arteries, and it can also semi-quantify, give us a rough idea for how much coronary calcification there is. And we'll say upfront, the most important difference is there calcium or is there no calcium? But then if there is calcium, the amount of coronary calcium determined by a score that we can talk more about if you wish, is the next important thing.
So the important number is zero calcium, less than zero or more than zero. Is there an upper number like 300, 400 Agatston units that we are concerned about?
That's a loaded question, and historically, we've subdivided a score into absent, into mild calcification, which goes from 1 to 100, moderate calcification, which goes from 101 to either 300 or 400, depending on whose literature you read, and everything above 400, we considered severe calcification, with the understanding that there are people who have other underlying disease. For example, patients with end-stage renal disease who have calcium scores in the thousands, but it may mean something different than what we're looking for, which is how much is the patient at risk of having a heart attack or a stroke.
So who should consider having a scan, and should it be the patient that decides, the physician, the caregiver, the provider? Should be a combined effort, or should we just have our patients just go to the nearest imaging center and order one on themselves?
In medicine, we test if we're not sure if a condition is present. We don't test if we know a patient has the disease that we're looking for. So a 20-year-old woman who doesn't smoke and has no risk factors but has chest pain or is worried about her risk, statistically, she'll be at such low risk for having disease, having calcium, that we just shouldn't test. On the other hand, take a 65-year-old diabetic smoker with hypertension, who maybe even has occasional chest pain when they're active. That person has high probability of having the disease. So testing also won't help us there. In addition, once a patient has established heart artery disease, such as prior heart attack, prior stroke, prior bypass surgery, prior stents, they're also not good candidates. Understand that the calcium is a screening tool. And in patients who already have the disease, we're not screening anymore. So patients with established heart artery disease are also not great candidates for this test. It's the people where, after we do the initial assessment of their risk, are in the intermediate risk category, where the calcium information can help us to reclassify them from intermediate risk to no risk, right? Or to higher risk. And that's how what we base our decisions on.
And is there ever too young of a patient? You know, the calcium hasn't had a chance to show up yet, that you would say, let's not do a CT scan for calcium?
Well, so, you know, what I think isn't important. But if we just look at the data that we're working with, you remember that we have normative data where we can compare people's calcium scores to peers of the same race, age, and gender. And in one database, the youngest age that we can compare to others is 35. In another database, it's 40. So I think I would keep it there. If there is really reason to worry, say it's a 38-year-old patient whose father died at the age of 42 suddenly and unexpectedly, I think it's reasonable to proceed. But if it's just a standard patient who is worried about their risk and we think their risk based on presence of diabetes, smoking, blood pressure, and so on, is in the intermediate category, I would wait at least until they're 40.
Then how about how to use this? Do you use the MESA score, which incorporates the calcium score into the patient's risk?
So I think you and I may disagree a little bit on this one. I think it should all start with doing our conventional risk assessment. And I know that we'll be changing to something else shortly. What we currently use has been in place for 11 years now. And the conventional risk factors that we take into account are presence or absence of diabetes, presence or absence of smoking, the upper of the two blood pressure numbers, the systolic blood pressure. Number four, does it take medicines to get to that blood pressure? So the fact alone that a patient is taking blood pressure medicines is a risk factor, the total cholesterol and the good cholesterol. And our risk model weighs these different risk factors and their magnitude and then comes up with a risk assessment. Yeah. As close as it gets to zero, up to 5%, and 5% is the 10-year risk of having a heart attack or a stroke. Up to 5%, we consider that low. If it's 5.1 to 7.5%, we call that borderline. And then there is this huge intermediate range, which goes from 7.5% all the way to 20%. And again, I would hone in on the patients that are at least intermediate risk, 7.5 to 20%, and in some cases, the borderline risk patients. So those are the patients where it's useful. And if the patient has at least intermediate pretest probability or intermediate risk, then we could use the coronary calcium scan to decide whether they should be on medicines. and the medicines that we typically offer in that context based on the coronary calcium score are statins. And that we sometimes do even in patients whose cholesterol isn't terribly high, but statins do things to vascular health that go in above and beyond lowering the LDL cholesterol. So if a patient who doesn't have terribly high cholesterol but has a high calcium score, let's say somewhere more than 100, that in my mind and based on the guidelines would be a candidate for taking statins to lower overall risk, not just the cholesterol numbers. And then, you know, many things make sense in medicine, but they're not fully borne out by science and fact. But you all know that the second medicine that we often use is aspirin. As opposed to statins, where nothing ever happens, aspirin has a tangible risk of bleeding. So we want to make sure that aspirin is a good deal for the patient. And there also, we'd look for a coronary calcium score, maybe, I don't know what you think, in the 300s, 400s. There we could say that the risk of taking aspirin outweighs the risk of not taking aspirin, just letting things progress.
As long as they don't have underlying bleeding problems.
That's very good advice.
And then what do you tell them about lifestyle?
Well, and that's the basis of it all. So lifestyle falls into the categories of physical activity, and the outcome of physical activity should be objective fitness. So if we put somebody on a treadmill, they should be able to at least perform average to peers of the same age and sex. Diet. And what we're looking for in the diet is low calorie, low sodium, and low fat. So Mayo Clinic likes to recommend the Mediterranean diet, or for people who already struggle with high blood pressure, the so-called DASH diet that emphasizes low sodium intake. And the low calories, of course, are meant to help people maintain weight. And I hate to say it, but weight is where all the risk factors tie in together at the end. Weighing too much makes the blood pressure higher than it needs to be, makes the cholesterol higher than it needs to be, can lead to non-restorative sleep, also known as sleep apnea. And sleep apnea in itself will trigger higher blood pressure. So diet and exercise are important. The diet to make sure that we don't eat too many calories and that we eat good building blocks, not too much refined sugar, not too much saturated fat. The exercise is more important for cardiovascular conditioning. Again, objective fitness that will lower a patient's risk. But in the end, an exercise program is not the key to maintaining weight if a patient eats enough calories. So that's the lifestyle part, and everybody ideally should be doing this. It takes a coronary calcium score to allow people to see that they have the beginnings of heart artery disease, and we can use that as an argument to try and convince them of lifestyle changes, great. But if they're already doing all the right things, or mostly doing the right things, and they still have calcium, that's, and only then, where medications come in.
Yeah, that's a great point. And do you think that a CT scan showing a patient their calcium will motivate them to adhere to meds or change lifestyle?
Studies have gone both ways. People looked into that in different cohorts, different people. I think, yes, especially if it's carefully explained, but there are also data that said that patients don't pay heed to that. But in all honesty, you have to wonder how well it was explained to the patient. what how important.
Now, what about follow-up, Tom? How often do you get follow-up? Do they need them if you already have calcium? Certainly, you've already said if they have disease, you don't really need a scan at all.
So I'm worried that I'll exceed my time limit, but coronary calcification by CT is not an exact science. If you scan the same patient twice, same day, same scanner, you can bank up a 10 to 20% variability for the second measurement. So there is this built-in inaccuracy. In addition, we know that coronary calcium does nothing but increase over time. So let's say we had a patient who had a calcium score of 400 3 years ago, and now the calcium score is 300. We don't know how much of it is measurement variability and how much of it is progression. Plus, we don't really know how to incorporate progression into decision-making. We think there is really no value at this point in regular coronary calcium scanning. So there is two types of patients. If a patient had any coronary calcification, we take that as the basis to make treatment decisions and advice on lifestyle. But the coronary calcium score should never be checked again according to current guidelines. If somebody has a coronary calcium score of zero, which is very good news indeed, the guidelines say that we could recheck a coronary calcium score. They say 5 to 10 years, but I think 3 to 5 years would also be reasonable. But once their coronary calcium score turns positive, then we'd also stop following them regularly. But it's important to understand that serial coronary calcium scanning to see how we're doing with our lifestyle changes is not advisable at this point.
Well, Tom, you've given us some great advice. That you use the intermediate types of patients. They're the ones that get the best, most benefit from getting a CT scan for calcium, probably. If it's negative, you can repeat it in a few years, 3 to 5. If they're positive, it's not going to really give us much information. You've certainly pointed out that giving statins, lifestyle, very helpful in these patients. Probably even aspirin if they don't have bleeding risk and it's a markedly high calcium scan. And you really are following the guidelines as the guidelines have recommended. I think there's great science there. So I really appreciate your insights and information. Any final words you'd like to impart?
Well, yeah, I always have final words. So one group that we haven't talked about are those who have no coronary calcification. So the data tells us that they have a low risk of heart attack over the next 5 to 10 years. And in terms of medications, except if they have sky-high cholesterol or are diabetic, they don't need to be on statins. But it's important to not take a coronary calcium score of zero as permission to eat like you want and to not exercise. So it's not that reassuring. So we, as I said, we should all be doing the right things all the time. And a coronary calcium score of zero is not permission to continue bad lifestyle habits.
That is probably the most important advice of all. Well, thank you, Dr. Tom Gerger, for your insights. And thank you all for listening. We hope to see you again soon.